I'm giving you a presentation. I was asked, oh, thank you a lot for the invitation, by the way, about the last 15 years that I've been living in sub-Saharan Africa doing research. I'm a forester by training, so my interest initially was sustainable forest management, forest certification, but then I ended up doing a lot of research on illegal trade and timber value chain or charcoal value chain. So I give you just a perspective of what the situation is in sub-Saharan Africa. It's a biased presentation towards sub-Saharan Africa, but the topics on which the Professor Koch took, European Union, timber regulation, etc., also deal a lot with timber coming from Africa to Europe, to China, to India, to all parts of the globe. And it's divided into the three of there, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I won't say which one is which, but I want to make clear what is the situation and what could be good, what could be bad, and what is really, really ugly. So this is an introduction of three timber sector, I would say. There are not one single forest sector in sub-Saharan Africa. The first one is probably largely most of the timber that has been discussed in the previous presentation. It's coming from these industrial concessions, okay? These are large-scale logging concessions, mostly exporting timber all over the world. What they do is having sawmills in the forest, and they produce things that then in Europe we use for things that you know very well. Now, on the beaches, benches, windows, framing, etc., etc. You have it in Europe. There are other constructions all over the world. This is one of the topics on illegal timber trade that came out first 10, 15 years ago, because the large-scale logging companies were the first to be named and shamed. What they leave behind in these logging concessions are, I would say, a state within the state, meaning that these large-scale logging concessions take the role of the state in many countries where actually the state has completely failed. So schools, hospital, roads, basically this is what this harvesting leave behind in the countries where they operate. Then you have another forest sector, which is made by chainsaw milling. That's the terminology that normally it is used. And this is not related to any particular sawmill. You go in the forest, you chop it down, you make planks with your chainsaw, and then those planks reach all over Africa, and sometimes also Europe and Southeast Asia. And what they leave behind is a very thriving local market. The rate of growth, the middle classes of Africa are growing. They have been growing for the past 15 years. So that timber not necessarily reaches Europe or outside Africa. It might stay within. And then you have what I would say the third type. The third type is about, oh, sorry, we also build very interesting, this is my university in Kisangani in Eastern DR Congo, and we just finished to build this one, and it's a very nice building, as you can see. And then you have the third one. And that third one, I use a key species here, so who knows what this species is? Tony, you can't talk. What species is this? What tree? How do you find this in the international market? Okay, it's one part of rosewood, but the name? Pterocarpus? Pterocarpus tinctorius. And very interestingly, this is we conducted a recent research for a couple of years between Zambia and China. This is not in the official Chinese list of rosewood. So when you look at the statistics, there is no rosewood that is coming from Zambia, Malawi, DR Congo. But all the traders know that this is Pterocarpus. This is rosewood, and it is sold and traded as rosewood. So who said it was Pterocarpus? You win a nice kikoi from Kenya. Voila. You're welcome. That's from Kenya. Nice product. So let me move on. And these are the products that are made with that, okay? You find it in Europe, it's used for parquet, for very high niche markets, but also especially in recent years, in Asia. Hongmu is a general term that is used there to cover rosewood, and I am told that one of the particular needs is this imperial style furniture, which is very requested by a rising middle class in Asia, in Southeast Asia, and especially in China. That's why you have that kind of exploitation. That exploitation, I would say, it's my third type, because what it leaves behind, it's a complete disaster. It's an environmental destruction I have never seen in my life after 15 years in Africa. I start a research, I finish the research, 2 years later, there is no forest left. And this is not often in the tropical humid forest. It's most of the time in miombo. And the miombo, you know better than I. When it's cut, it's cut. It's not coming back. So I would like to highlight that these three types are very different type of exploitation of the forest. And why I'm focusing on that? Because then you also have the trade-offs. So this is just look at this one. Before this market of rosewood with Zambia, Malawi, and Southern DRC, and Vietnam and China started, basically what people in the villages were are farmers. They do their farming. After the market comes, the demand for that tree come, entire villages, entire communities became loggers, which means that it's not a very clear-cut picture. There are livelihoods in rural areas that are nourished. People can send children to school and people to the hospital with this money. Unfortunately, this money is very, very short term. So after 5 years, when the market is gone and the harvesters are moved to another country, the people go back to do farming. But it's tricky, because when you have to talk to the minister and suggest solutions, it's not always black and white. So this is what is happening in the forest of sub-Saharan Africa very broadly. We can go into detail during the coffee break. Now, outside in the world, what is happening? Global tropical timber trade byproduct, it's going up, it's growing, and you see there's a lot of wood furniture growing more than others. For instance, logs are luckily not on the grow. That's the global picture. From Africa, not good. It's mostly log and sawn wood, meaning that there is no value addition. There are still logs coming out of Africa. And when you read sawn wood here, it's basically what I call squared logs. So they just square the log, put in a container, and off it goes. So no value addition, no industrialization that remains behind. And that's problematic. And the third one, I just use Cameroon because it's the country I've lived more. You see, the picture is that European demand has been stagnant for almost 10 years now. And it was actually going down since the beginning of the century. What is exponentially growing is it's Asian demand, which is largely in these last 5 years, Vietnam and China. So the big picture is trade is growing. It's growing from sub-Saharan Africa, unluckily stealing logs and sawn wood, and it's going to markets that generally are not considered very sensitive to whether the tree is legal, illegal, sustainable, or not sustainable. And that's a problem, because if the demand, even if Europe has a lot of, or the US or Australia, they have a regulation in place not to allow this timber to come in, the demand where it is today is not really receptive to this demand for legality and sustainability. And we need to talk to politicians, because this must change. Otherwise, we will have very nice scheme in Europe, but then the forest is gone anyway. So change is the title, and I just want to finish with three slides on what you can change. First of all, these messages, I don't like it. When you read that 90% of rainforest logging is done by illegal loggers, all immediately it means that you are criminalizing people. Most of these people are not criminal. This must be clear. Value chains are complex beasts, but not all people are criminal. And these are not good messages because you do not promote good trade. You just make boycotts, like in the past, on African timber, and nothing then happens and the situation does not improve. So what you can do is ask. If you don't know what the situation is about the product that you are buying, please inform yourself. There are information out there, there are institutions that just do that for a job. So do not always consider everything that is coming out of sub-Saharan Africa as bad, bloody, corrupt, and not good. It's not true. The second one is customs discrepancies. So this, again, I take Cameroon. I'm sorry if there is Cameroonian people here, putting them on the spot. But over the last 3 years, when you look at trade discrepancies between what Cameroon declare as exported and what a sample of countries here, China, Vietnam, and Belgium, declare as import, same products, same country, millions of dollars of discrepancy. So for instance, from Vietnam to Cameroon, in the last 2 years, you had about 700,000 cubic meters of timber that was not accounted for. It means that trees can grow in the sea. So they never leave Cameroon, but the boats arrive full in Vietnam. Okay, we have solved the problem of restoration, Alexander. This is a problem. And when you are buying, why I put ask to ask? Because this is your politician's responsibility. You need, before buying your chair, to tell your politician, your MP, that you want the data of your own custom, of your own country, Germany, Italy, Austria, to know exactly what is the situation in the trade relation with that country, be it China, Vietnam, Italy, or Lebanon. If we don't do that, it seems that these custom discrepancies keep going on and on. I mean, we have algorithms that correct for this data. They can do it. Artificial intelligence now, it's even better than in the past. But come on, 2019, 600,000 cubic meter, and nobody is saying anything between the World Custom Organization or our governments. That's not good. Third one, when you buy that chair, there are out there schemes, things that can help you decide between the good, the bad, and the ugly. At the moment, I have nothing else than forest certification. I'm a taker, so if you come up with another solution, much better. But from sub-Saharan African perspective, I'm just showing a little research that we did a few years back. So the green line here, these are all indicators. I don't go into the details. These are all indicators on environmental impact, socioeconomic impact, and financial impact. The green lines are the results on certified logging companies. The other one are non-certified logging companies. The picture that you see here, without going into the detail, is that certification helps. The products that are issued from certified concessions are better socially, environmentally, and financially than products that are produced without that certification. Okay? I'm not saying that we are in paradise. Certification is not yet where we would like it to be. But if you compare, and we must always compare with something, there is no other sign that you can have on that chair when you buy it, that it's at least it has some good in it. And so ask to ask to ask. This is what in political economy governance you call it third party certification. Why? Because there is a third party that is independent from me, the producer, and you, the government, then go and check into that logging concession that the standards are respected. Again, it's not perfect, but it's working. And if you have to buy tree timber from tropical countries, please ask the buyer where this timber is coming from. How can you tell me that this chair I'm buying from you is from a sustainably managed operation? If they cannot tell you, go to another seller, be it the IKEA or the others of the planet. They must be able to tell you where the timber is coming from. So the last point is that you here, we are not scientists, I'm talking to the consumers in you. We are responsible for this. We are responsible for the 1, 2, or 5 degrees. And 1, 2, or 5 degrees in climate change will change completely our life in our own generation. So do not expect for people, organization, IUFRO or other to create the solutions for you. It's you, when you buy that chair, then can make really the change for what's happening far away in sub-Saharan Africa, also for the people that take care of those forests. Thank you very much.